Thank you indeed, and good morning to everybody. First of all, a big, big thank you to the organizers for being in Copenhagen again, and also for inviting me to give my perspective on something that I think is really, really important, is how are we getting ahead with the technologies, in particular digital technologies. So with this very long title from my keynote, and you know how it is, during lockdown I was asked, could you give a keynote on this, and no problem, and then reality comes up and I say, well, it's nearly a synopsis. But anyway, what I will do is I will give you my perspective as a maritime regulator and a Danish public maritime policy perspective on how I see things right now. And hopefully I will provoke some thoughts and fuel the debate that you're going to have later on today. And as I told Peter Sand from BIMCO, I have a lot of feelings and perceptions and thoughts about this. I don't have any objective data, so this is how I see the world, and that's so I want to stress that, so it's like an invitation for discussion. Anyway, right now, we are still at the wake, in the afterwake maybe, of the pandemic. Even though outside Denmark, outside Europe, there's still a lot of things to do with the pandemic situation. But it is, I would say, a very disruptive time. And I was just thinking that about 2 years ago, before COVID-19, when we talked about digitalization, we said, digitalization is going to disrupt everything. And we all said, yes, it's going to disrupt. But we didn't know what disruption was, really. But have we really learned something from COVID-19 is that disruption means that everything changes. Everything as we know it changes completely. And what I think is also is happening now after the COVID-19 pandemic is that it's presenting a new normal in many ways. And I think it sort of opened the doors in our minds to start thinking about all the stuff that we are doing in a new way. So it's a very good time to talk about digitalization and technology and how to move forward. Climate, as Sophia, the chair, just mentioned, climate is back on top of the agenda. Everybody is now not discussing, are we going to do something? But we are discussing now, what can we do now and how fast can we do it? So there's no doubt that the climate agenda and the climate change agenda will be one of the key drivers for technology and technology development in the future. And I'm talking about technology in a very wide sense. Even new fuel types, new kind of engines, new kind of ships, new kind of operational models, business models, etc. So it's going to be a key driver of development in a broad sense. And then we have digitalization, which I also believe at least have the potential to be a key driver for technology development. But I think that there's a huge difference on the two. And there's something about a chicken and egg situation, which is different from looking at how we're working with addressing the climate change agenda and how we're working with digitalization. And since this forum is very much, originally at least, about smart shipping, I will dwell about the digitalization. And we all know that digital systems in shipping have a huge potential for a huge impact on safety, resilience, greening, efficiency, and a lot of other things. And talking about safety, I just took the statistics from the EMSA, European Maritime Safety Agency, their report from 2020. The next report will be, I think, in December, so this is the latest figures. But looking at the statistics for shipping in Europe, the maritime activities in Europe, in the year 2014 to 19, more than 19,000 incidents involving more than 21,000 ships. 496 casualties or people fatalities, that means people that perished, and 493 severe accidents. 833 of these incidents have been screened in a thorough investigation. And the result shows that 44% of all the accidents had a reason that sort of roots back to navigational nature. human action, more than half. And as a pre-seafarer, I'm a firm believer that if we have 19,000 incidents, then we have at least 50,000 near misses that humans actually made sure that it didn't become an accident. But the fact remains that looking at the accidents, more than half, there's something about human action. And 63.9% was something to do with ship-related procedures. How are things operated on board? Now that gives, I would say, fuel for thinking about, could we do better here? And I will just show you a small video here, which is the AIS track from an incident in the northern fjord of Denmark, Limfjorden it's called. A ship coming in, bumping into a bridge, actually completely dismantling the northern part of Denmark from the railroad for more than 6 months. And that was it. No pilot on board, And then the captain found a place where he could stop and think about it. Anyway, what is really, really interesting here is if you look at the bottom of the screen, there's a lot of real-time data collected here. There's a lot of data here, and I am quite confident, I'm totally sure, that you could have an algorithm that could treat this, process this, and in real time actually send a warning and predict this accident is going to happen. We already have some of these algorithms developed in detecting abnormal behavior, but it's not sort of disseminated into the industry. It's not being embraced, it's not being used. Wärtsilä made an analysis, also McKinsey, clearly documenting that many of the transport chains, including shipping, they're inefficient. A lot of time is wasted, waiting here. I know that right now we have bottleneck issues, historical, and it's not, maybe not, it's a very special situation right now, but pre-corona and post-corona, we will get back to this, and I would say that in terms of energy efficiency, I know Maria is going to probably say something about that later and you're going to discuss it, but there's definitely a huge potential using algorithm to optimize the way that we are navigating the ships so that we have everything just in time. It's about, again, using digital tools to plug in to the ecosystems and have everything coordinated with each other. And it has been demonstrated and documented in several reports that there's a huge potential. But it's not very well used around the world. And then we have something about the burden of paperwork. Actually, if a container ship is leaving Helsinki in Finland and visits 5 European ports before they stop in Rotterdam, the captain has to state his name 150 times. And has to submit papers when he gets into port and receive papers. If a seafarer signs on and signs off, then you have a folder which weighs maybe 5 kilo of papers, certificates for each seafarer. And we know, because that's the way we do it ashore, that now we have digital, everything is digital. Even in Denmark now we have digital driver license. And I have all my tax papers, my banking papers, everything is done through an app on my smartphone, but not at sea, no. If we just look at digital certificates, where we know for a fact that ships and seafarers are spending a huge amount of time, and authorities likewise spending a lot of time on checking and issuing and doing same with the classification societies, we know that digital certificates would definitely be a tool to improve efficiency. And actually, I would say this year in DMA, we are launching a digital certificate for seafarers with the vision that it will be much easier for seafarers and ships and authorities. We just have one problem, is that we're the only one who's doing that. So we will give people a certificate that nobody else are able to communicate with. But we will see what happens. But that's one of my points. And I think that we are launching digital certificates. We have done it also for ships. And we see things happening around. We see pilot projects, different kind of things. I know many of you here are working with different digital solutions. So I would say that we are actually looking at a lot of tops of the icebergs. But I'm asking this question is, why are we just seeing the top? What is it? I mean, what I'm saying now, I said that probably 10 years ago, and I've discussed it with many of you here, it's not really taking off when we're talking about digitalization. And I'm just curious again, and asking the question to myself and you, what is it? Why is it that we do not embrace digital technologies when there's such huge potential in increasing safety, efficiency, making things smarter, better, easier? So I would say again, as I've said many times before, if you look at the ship as a piece of technology, we do have tradition for really innovating and developing and coming up with a lot of smart things. New kind of ship construction, hull constructions, painting, engines, propellers, all kind of equipment. But if we look at the ship as a process, input, outputs, resources, standards, then it's a black box. And honestly speaking, and I hope this will provoke some, everybody is using the same operational model, and it was designed hundreds of years ago with a small adjustment when the engines came in and we took a marine engineer on board. But ever since then, we are running the same operational model when we look at the operation of the ship. So we do not have a tradition for, can we do this smarter? Could we do it in another way? Is it you who's going to do this, or should I do it, or should we have an algorithm do it? We don't have this tradition. Many people say, well, the reason that we're not moving ahead is that we need standards. And I agree, we do need standards. But then, I've advocated that around, that we need to work with standards. But then I was just thinking the other day, standards for what? And I think that's one of the problems also, that we're not even able to really define that we need standards for this and that in order to move ahead. And that leads me to the question, is it the fact that when we're talking about digitalization, we don't have a shared picture of where are we heading? Why are we doing it? Two very impressive technology projects is the project announced in 1963 by JFK Kennedy, we're going to put a man on the moon. Nearly 20 years ago, China did the same. So the goal is we're going to put a man on the moon, and they are developing a lot of technology because they all know what they're doing. So they're all working in the same direction. And if you just think about all the technology that the Apollo project actually led to, and it's my perception that by having a vision on where are we heading, it becomes much more easier to talk about what kind of standards do we need, what kind of technology do we need, what kind of algorithm do we need to develop. And again, I think here's the difference between the greenhouse gas agenda and the digitalization agenda in shipping. When we're talking about greenhouse gas, we all know that the target is we are going to be climate neutral. And that's why everybody who works with this know where they're heading. They need to develop new fuel. They need to come up with engines that's much more energy efficient. And we need to find standards that can actually facilitate that. But in digitalization, we don't have the same. So I would say, at least in DMA, we're going to aim for having a common vision that we will strive for. Zero navigational accidents in Danish ships and Danish waters. Paperless shipping, it has to be our common target. We will strive for that, at least in Denmark. No more paper on board. No more paper on board. This is, after all, 2021. It should be able to do that. Automatic surveillance. And then I just put some dots, because then the floor is open for, you know, what should the vision be. But we need it in order to have a common target or shared target that we can all pursue. When we have that, then we can start talking about regulation and standards. And then regulation and standards, I think it's important to know that it's a two-edged sword. One, and that's what we want, ensure safety, level playing field, a standard where we know if we all comply with this standard and this set of regulation, we will be home free, we can sell our product and we can use the product. But they also set limits, and first movers know that. When they have an idea that we, if we just could do this, and then somebody comes and says, no, you can't, because in the regulation, it says something else. And then we need to change that, but change takes time. That's a downside of a global regulatory framework that we have. It takes time. So looking at first movers, which we need still, and this comes back to the chicken and egg situation, we need first movers. We need somebody like you with a good idea to come forward. But when we tell you about time, we know for a fact that time kills first movers. The business will not fly, they cannot go on, they give up. We have taken stock of that in DME, and we see that both with the greenhouse gas agenda, where new technology, new fuel types, new ways of operating are coming into play. And we also see the first bunch of first movers coming with proposed digital solutions. And we said, how can we cope with this and ensure that first movers actually feel that there's a way forward here? So we have established what we call the DMA Regulatory Future Lab. And we invite any first mover, being a producer or a shipping company or anybody else, that says, I have this idea that I want to pursue, then we're in for business. We are sitting down, we're establishing projects, going in with you in the design phase and finding out where are the rules challenged and what will the solution be. And we hope, and we have already seen a few examples. We have Bjorn sitting here, our innovation manager, who is heading this future lab. But we think that's a way ahead. So when the question was, how can authorities, what can we do to sort of promote and ensure that we can future-proof technology for shipping, I think this is one of the ways. We have to be clear still on how we're working with the regulatory framework, but while we are waiting, we need to pave the way for first movers. So this is basically the message from me, that there's a lot of potential, there's also a lot of hard work still to do, but again, I think that we are some authorities, and I think more and more flag state authorities will move in this direction. We will at least try to get them on board so that we can all have technology develop on the forefront on regulation and to the benefit for a green and prosperous shipping industry. So with this, I hope I fueled your discussion going on later today, and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andreas. Do we have any questions to Andreas from the floor?
Thank you. Andreas, thank you very much. Very interesting. My name is Giampiero Soncini. I'm the CEO of IB, and I've been 50 years in IT in shipping. I look young, but I'm 50 years in doing this. So you said a lot of things which have been extremely interesting, but one of the things you pointed out is that, of course, you're doing something now, and you are alone, like the digitalization of the certificates. And one of the main problem that I've always seen in shipping all my life is that there is no conjunction of ideas amongst all the various shipping chambers, shipping organizations. IMO is a political institution that is serving no interest anymore to the shipping community. So what are you going to do about it? Well, I mean, look at the seafarer situation in the last 2 years. What has IMO done about it? Absolutely zero. But let's leave that aside. But if we don't standardize the way we work, and if we don't find a common solution, for instance, on a notice of arrival into ports about noon reporting, there are 24,000 shipping companies in the world. They have 24,000 different noon reporting. Why can't we have standards like the aeronautical industry has done with the IATA, International Air Traffic Association, transport association. Why can't we have it in shipping so that we standardize the way we work, and when we arrive into a port, we don't have to fill up 130 different forms?
Well, I don't know if it was a rhetorical question, but because I asked the same question, I agree that we have an issue here. And I've, for instance, if you talk about standardizing the ship, the port procedures, I mean, we have in Europe, we have introduced what we call a single window, but it's not a single window. It's a single window that, you know, we have a directive that everybody has to make their own single window, just, you know, it amazes me. Why don't we have one single window? But I think it boils down to a lot of things. I think that there's, and this is maybe where we as regulators should also communicate with the political level and say we need to have a political vision that this is how things should be done in Europe or in shipping. And then we need to also have the people who work. I think actually there's also some resistance that in each country we have IT departments that work with things in a certain way, and giving, you know, into a European solution, I think it leads to resistance. That's just one example.
But we have been able to build up equities, we have been able to build up port state control, which is unique all over the world. So yes. Why aren't we able to do the rest? I don't know, because
we
I'm
are.
Not part of the...
But you were pointing exactly. I mean, in Europe we have fantastic IT systems that we share, but it's on a voluntary basis. And I can tell you that just accident statistics, DMA, I asked the questions, I asked that for a couple of years, how are we doing on safety? And, you know, I wanted some, you know, performance indicators. And then finally we got in touch with EMSA and we found they have a treasury of data, but nobody has used it. And they were just so happy that finally a maritime authority came and asked them and gave them feedback on how to use data. So we're not there yet. I mean, we have the same, I think the authorities around in Europe and the world have the same challenges as in the shipping companies. We are not aware of what's possible, but we need to work with it. And I agree also on the sharing of experiences, and we need to showcase the good examples. But my experience is also that very often when we have discussions with shipping companies or manufacturers of software solutions, they want to keep everything, you know, in hiding until they're able to actually get out and go to the market with it, because they're afraid of competitors taking the ideas. So I think that there are many challenges on this. But the way ahead is definitely just to be open and discuss it, like we're doing now. I think that's one of the ways that we're going to move forward here.
Okay. Thank you, Andreas.
Thank you.